would you die for? Your family? A belief system? Or an idea? Would you die for freedom? It's not every day that a question like this would be asked, but then again, what would warrant such a question? Now, as I take time to analyze parts of Black history, which is American history, I realize that buzzwords like freedom and liberty really don't have a shared meaning when it comes to my people and other minority groups. Fortunately, I was reminded of an organization that embodies the passion, economic empowerment, and bravery that I feel are key elements for African Americans to thrive in the U.S. today. I'm talking about none other than the Black Panthers, Portraits from an Unfinished Revolution. So allow me to shed light on these Black Panthers. Over the next few videos, I'll share how this organization sparked a movement that shook the system of oppression and marginalization, as well as gave credence to Black vanguards such as Huey Newton, Eldridge Cleaver, and Assata Shakur. And what I love about this book in particular is that it takes a reader on the bottom-up journey of seeing how the Black Panther Party was operating on a day-to-day basis. Now, what I also appreciate about this collection of portraits is that it humanizes a movement that was quickly deemed as criminal. So in this video, I'll talk about how the Black Panthers got started, and I'll finish with sharing a couple of stories that resonated with me from this collection of portraits. The Black Panthers were founded in Oakland, California in 1962 by Huey Newton and Bobby Seale. Revered as a symbol of beauty and protection, this animal, the Black Panther, went from being spotted in various places in Africa, such as Ethiopia and the forests in Mount Kenya, to becoming the symbol of brotherhood and sisterhood that swore and pledged to educate themselves on their history. Some of the most notable works that they studied in the Black Panther Party include Frantz Fanon's Wretched of the Earth, Marcus Garvey's Garvey and Garveyism, and Michael Harrington's The Other America. Now, in my opinion, these books were centered around the philosophy of reclaiming power and identity that was stripped from you while living in a land where the leaders of that land didn't have your best interest at hand. For example, history books will tell you that African slaves were freed around 1865 because of the Emancipation Proclamation. But where were the resources, education, or even a helping hand to those former slaves who were freed from the physical shackles but still enslaved mentally? See, that's what I'm talking about. And see, the Black Panther Party saw this mental enslavement in the 1960s. They saw it in zoning laws, they saw it in legislation, they even saw it in the criminal justice system. And so they were left to think, what justice is in store for people who are already labeled criminals? It was through this common realization and restlessness that Blacks and other minority groups came together and contributed their tireless efforts, knowledge, and skills to make a self-sustainable Black community that would hopefully spread across the nation. So one story I'd like to share from this book, The Black Panthers, is a story of Ronald Elder Freeman, who's actually on the cover of this book. So he grew up in Detroit and he was affiliated with the Marcus Garvey Universal Negro Improvement Association, and he rose through the ranks of the Black Panther Party. Now see, his story sticks out to me because he knows what injustice looks like firsthand by seeing innocent brothers and sisters of his being shot and killed out on the street by law enforcement. Man, he even goes on to say in this book that he witnessed cops planting guns inside their establishment, doing a 360 and saying they have illegal weapons. His story, like many others, are threaded by a recurring theme of disdain towards law enforcement, basically those sworn to protect and serve. So, what do you do when people who are sworn to protect and serve don't swear to protect you? You grip up and you show your other brothers and sisters how to handle firearms to protect themselves and their community. Look, he and the other Black Panthers knew that the Second Amendment wasn't written with African Americans in mind, but since they were born in the U.S., they had a right to bear arms. Now, other Black Panther Party members, such as Erica Huggins, really captures the true essence of the organization because she believed in educating young people and helping the community by any way possible. Now, throughout my videos of the Black Panther Party, I'll continue to delve into these stories, but I'll finish with this. One of Malcolm X's most memorable phrases was, "By any means necessary." Now, although an outsider would probably interpret this phrase as something linked to violence, you gotta understand that Malcolm X was talking to the crippled citizens of America, asking them to examine the system around them, look at viable options, the means, and use these means to take down the obstacles in front of them. And I believe that the Black Panthers were doing just that. This has been the Black Curriculum.